Today's lecture for artificial intelligence is based on fuzzy logic. This is for fifth semester. We have already discussed several topics on intelligent systems, and this is one of them. Fuzzy logic has already been started in the classes, and now we have this is the video lecture for this particular topic. Now this human knowledge nowadays becomes increasingly important. We gain it from experiencing the world within which we live and use our ability to reason, to create order in the mass of information, that is to formulate human knowledge in a systematic manner. Since we are limited in our ability to perceive the world and perform the reasoning, we find ourselves everywhere confronted by uncertainty, which is the result of lack of information, lexical imprecision, incompleteness, in particular inaccuracy of measurements. The other limitation factors in our desire for precision is natural language used for describing, sharing knowledge, communication, etc. We understand the meaning of this word and are able to communicate accurately and acceptable degree, but generally we cannot precisely agree among ourselves on the single word or terms of common sense meaning. In short, languages are vague. So let us try to understand what do we mean by this. And our perception of the real world is preserved by concepts which do not have sharply defined boundaries. For example, we generally in the language we adopt certain particular adjectives, certain words like many, tall, much, larger, than, young, etc. in our language, and are truly to some degree, they are false to some degree as well. They are true to some extent and then they are false to certain extent. The concept of facts can be fuzzy or gray way concept of human brain works with them, while computers may not do it. The reason with strings, zeros and ones. Natural languages, which are much higher in level than the programming languages, are fuzzy, whereas programming languages are not. Since programming languages are very, very precise, they will do whatever is asked. The fuzziness is there in the natural language that we speak. I am saying he is very young. So this is somewhat fuzzy in nature. And the person is very, very tall. So the degree of tallness is not known, and this creates the value of fuzziness. The door to the development of fuzzy components was opened in 1985 by the design of the first logic chip by Masaaki Togayo and Hiroki Wanatabe at Bell Labs, Bell Telephone Laboratories, Bell Labs. In the years to come, fuzzy computers will employ fuzzy hardware. Now this fuzzy hardware will also be utilized, fuzzy software along with the fuzzy software, which is much closer in structure to the human brain. Now this concept will be utilized in formation of computers, fuzzy logic. In the entire world is very complex. It is found that complexity arises from uncertainty in the form of ambiguity. The fuzzy logic tool was introduced in 1965 by Lothar V. Jade. This is the person who created this concept and mathematical tool for dealing with uncertainty. Now, it offers to a soft computing partnership the important concepts of computing with words. It provides techniques to deal with imprecision and information granularity. The fuzzy theory provides mechanisms for representing linguistic constructs. These are linguistic constructs. This is a very important word that we have to use in our jargon. This is linguistic construct, which many, low, medium, often, few. These are few of the linguistic constructs here. In general, the fuzzy logic provides an inference structure that enables appropriate human reasoning capabilities. And inference structure. Now this fuzzy logic provides some sort of inference structure. In our brain, we will try to interpret the information and then appropriate human reasoning capability. This develops human reasoning capabilities. On the contrary, the traditional binary set theory describes crisp events. Now we will see the difference here. The traditional binary set theory that we have already studied in the previous classes is based on CRISP theory. Okay, and the events are either they will occur or they will not occur. So in the either they will be 0 or there will be 1, and there will be nothing in between. So in the as we have read in the digital electronics also, and the same concept is applied here. Which a given event is expected to occur. It uses probability theory to explain if an event will occur, measuring the chance with which given event is expected to occur. Now this is the based on certain set of probability of occurring of that event. The theory of fuzzy logic is based upon the notation of relative gradient membership, and so are the functions of mentation and cognitive processes. It is based on human cognitive process. The utility of fuzzy sets lies in either their ability to model uncertain and ambiguous data. Now this is very important here. This uncertain, ambiguous data which is not clear. We are not sure about that particular data and often encountered in our daily life. This is the most important point that we have to note down. That this fuzzy logic, basically it is different from the CRISP logic in the sense that the fuzzy logic is dealing with the data which is generally not crisp in nature, whereas we have already attempted in our previous studies that crisp data, we have crisp threats, that is either they will occur or they will not occur, this type of things we have done. But this is based upon the probability concept that a particular event may occur or may not occur. It is important to observe that there is an intimate connection between fuzziness and complexity. So here, as the complexity of the task problem or a system performing the task exceeds a certain threshold, the system must necessarily become fuzzy in nature. Originally, this was given by Lothar Fijade, who is an engineer, and he has given this concept. And he says the concept of fuzziness and complexity of the problem are related with each other. As the complexity of the task or the problem of a system performing that task exceeds a certain threshold, the system must necessarily become fuzzy in nature. Okay, the system must become fuzzy in nature. It stresses on the increasing complexity, our ability to make precise and yet significant statements about behavior diminishes. Significant even, okay. We will not be able to tell significantly about a certain event. The real world problems or the situations are too complex, and the complexity involves the degree of uncertainty. This is the most important point, because in the real world we have certain set of degree of uncertainty in the events. Uncertainty increases, so does the complexity of the problem also increases. So uncertainty increases, complexity of the problem increases. Traditional system modeling and analysis technique are too precise for such problems. So in the degree of uncertainty or the fuzziness to achieve a satisfactory compromise between information, we would have amount of uncertainty we are willing to accept. Now this particular concept of fuzzy logic involves degree of uncertainty or fuzziness in the real-time world, and it will have the uncertainty to what extent we can accept that uncertainty. Okay, so in the next, The fuzzy set provides the fuzzy sets provide means to model uncertain certainty associated with the vagueness, imprecision, and the lack of information regarding the problem or a plan, etc. Now this fuzziness in the real-time application, we are vagueness, imprecision, lack of information regarding a problem in the plant or a plant. Okay, suppose we have got a particular company in which there is a continuous process plant is there, and there is some sort of degree of vagueness or fuzziness in the data. In there, we can deal with the concept of the consider the meaning of, now for example here, consider the meaning of short person for an individual X. Short person may be one whose height is 4 feet, 25 inches. For other individuals, Y, the short person may be one whose height is below or equal to 3 feet, 90 inches. This short is called linguistic descriptor. Linguistic descriptor, the term short informs the same meaning to the individual X and Y, but it is found that they both do not provide a unique definition. This is the most important point here. Now, in this particular case, you will note that we have taken an example here in which one person has got this height, 4 feet 25 inches, and another person has got the height, 3 feet 90 inches. Now, we will use a linguistic descriptive variable, descriptor or a descriptor, the term short. Now, short here, this particular thing, short, we say somebody is short. So, how short it is, or how small is this particular value, so we have to understand this. It's found that they both do not provide unique definition. If I say 3 feet 90 inches is short, or if I say 4 feet 25 inches is short, so we have to be very, very precise in this. The term short would be conveyed effectively only when a computer compares the given height value with the pre-assigned value of short. Now we have to assign, if somebody has to be called, if X is less than say 3 feet 90 inches, we will call printf, we will call that person as short. Now this particular thing, short, has to be defined here. Now this is what the meaning is. Compares the given value, pre-assigned value of short, this variable short is called as linguistic variable. Linguistic variable, which represents the imprecision existing in the system here. Now, imprecision means we do not have degree of measurement, we do not have amount. This denotes, if we say somebody is short. Now, how short? If we have defined it by 3 feet 90 inches, that means that if somebody is less than or equals to this particular value, then we will call that person as short. So here it is defining degree of imprecision. The uncertainty found to arise from ignorance or chance and to randomness due to lack of knowledge from vagueness, unclear, like fuzziness existing in our natural language. Now these are the factors, major factors from where the uncertainty or vagueness arises. From ignorance, from chance, from randomness, due to lack of knowledge, from the vagueness, unclear, like the fuzziness existing in the natural language. We can have the same concept in the natural language as well. Lokani Shastra proposed the set membership idea to make suitable decisions when uncertainty occurs. Consider a short example discussed previously. If we take short as a height equal to or less than 4 feet, then 3 feet 90 inches would easily become a member. Although short, and 4 feet 25 will not be a member of this set short. The membership value is 1 if it belongs to the set, or 0 if it doesn't belong to the set. Thus, membership of a set is found to be binary if the element is a member or set or not. So, therefore, this is very important paragraph. Now, let us try to understand what Lotofi has suggested in this particular thing. Now, if we say, Lotofi Jade proposed, if we want to, we are using the same previous example that we have used here of the short. If we say somebody is short, let us define short as equals to 4 feet. And if X less than equals to 3 feet 90 inches, it means printf, he or she is short. Because this particular value is definitely less than this particular 4 feet, which has been kept as short. Therefore, X is less than short, or we can write here, x is less than short. Therefore, a person is falling into that category, and 3 feet 9 inches would be there. But if somebody's height is say 4 feet 25 inches, he will not form a part of that particular set. So how is it indicated? This is the membership function here. Now this is indicated as mu ax, x will be equal to 1 if x belongs to the set, and if x is equal to 0, x doesn't belong to the set. This is the basic description. Mu ax is the membership of an element x in the set A, and A is the entire set on the universe. The membership was extended to possess various degrees of membership on the real world continuous interval 0 to 1. Zadeh formed fuzzy sets as the set on the universe X which can accommodate degree of membership. The concept of fuzzy set contrasts with the classical concepts of a bivalent set, crisp set, whose boundary is required to be precise. Crisp set is a collection of things, is known whether any given thing is inside or it or not. This is the gist of what we have learned so far. Now, crisp set is a collection of things for which it is known whether anything is inside it or not. Zadeh generalized the idea of crisp set by extending the evaluation set 1,0 definitely in or definitely out to the interval of real values, degree of membership between 1 and 0, denoted by this set 0 or 1. So here, this is for fuzzy and that is for the crisp set. We can say that the degree of membership for any particular element of a fuzzy set express the degree of compatibility of the element with the concept represented by fuzzy set. It means fuzzy set A contains an object A, x to degree Ax, that is Ax is equal to degree of x belongs to A, and map Ax to the membership degrees is called set function or membership. So, a function which maps a particular element is called its membership function. The fuzzy set A can be expressed as xAx, like x is the element and its Ax is its membership value. x belongs to x, and it imposes an elastic constraint on the possibility of values of x belongs to x is called the possibility distribution. Fuzzy sets tend to capture vagueness exclusively via membership functions. Now we will be using the membership function with the help of which we will be able to map the vagueness or fuzziness of an element. Say what is this, what is already written here, Ax is the membership of degree membership, and map Ax membership of this one degree. Okay, so Ax is the degree. That is what it is written there. X is the element and Ax is its membership. Now, fuzziness describes the ambiguity of an element, and randomness describes the uncertainty in the event. It can be generally seen in classical sets that there is no uncertainty and hence they have crisp boundaries. That in the case of fuzzy sets, since uncertainty occurs, the boundaries may be ambiguously specified. This is the major difference between crisp and fuzzy sets. So here, this ambiguity is there. It is not clearly defined. Crisp sets are clearly defined here. Now, imprecise data, vague statements passed on to the fuzzy logic system, they will lead to the decisions. Inference engine is there that will try to identify the value of membership, and then decisions will be taken on. A fuzzy logic system which accepts imprecise data and vague statements such as low, medium and high provides decisions. Now let us see this particular diagram. In this particular diagram, boundary region of a fuzzy set, it can be noted that A is clearly a member of fuzzy set B, C is clearly not a member of fuzzy set B, but the membership of B is found to be vague. Hence, A can be member value 1, C can take membership value 0, and B can take membership value between 0 and 1, say 0.4, 0.7, like this. This set to be partial membership of fuzzy set P. Now, if you take the example of tall and short of the heights of individuals, the classification here, this short goes down and tall is height and membership. Highest value membership 1, highest membership value for this also is 1. Minimum value is 0, minimum value is 0. So, subjective, it depends on height is measured relative to and extends distinctions clearly large amount of overlap in the middle. There is a large amount of overlap in the middle that we can see here between the two. Okay. There is an overlap between the two sets, and the reason is uncertainty here. Now, fuzzy set in X, now what does this indicate? Configuration of a pure fuzzy system. There is a fuzzy set in X, there is a fuzzy rule base, then fuzzy inference engine is applied, and then fuzzy sets in Y are generated. So, fuzzy if-then-else we have already discussed, fuzzy if-then-else rules which have general if X then Y is B, where A and B are fuzzy sets. The term fuzzy system refers to mostly the systems that are governed by fuzzy if-then rules. If part of an implication is called antecedent. This is antecedent, and the second part that after the then is statement is called consequent. Rules that convert inputs to outputs. The basic configuration of a pure fuzzy system is as shown in earlier, we have seen here. And fuzzy inference engine algorithm combines fuzzy if then else rules. Now, fuzzy if then else rules, mapping from fuzzy set in the input space X to the fuzzy sets in the output space Y based on fuzzy logic principles. So, fuzzy if then else rules are generally right. Classical set. Consider classical set X denote the, now let us try to understand the differences, clear cut differences between classical sets and the fuzzy sets. Let us take some examples here. Consider classical set X denotes the universe of discourse or universal set. Individual elements in the universe X will be denoted as X. The features of the elements in X can be discrete, countable integers, continuous valued quantifiers. Of real 9 examples of the elements of various universes might be the clock speeds of computers of CPU. This is very, very bizarre. Operating temperature of an air conditioner, you are fixing it to 24, 25, 30, like this. The operating currents of an electronic motor or generator set, the integers 1 to 100, they are precise. They are classical sets or crisp values. The total number of elements in the universe X is called its cardinal number. This discrete universe is compressed of countable finite collection of elements and has finite cardinal number, and the continuous universe consists of uncountable infinite collection of elements and thus has infinite cardinal number. That is the important point you have to note down. Yeah, this. So, if the set is countable, cardinality is countable. If not, infinite cardinal number will be there. So, what is cardinal number? Total number of elements in the universe X is its cardinality. You have to understand this cardinality. And it is denoted by the X, and this discrete universe is composed of countable finite collection of elements. So, in the crisp set, either continuous or discrete. Yeah. As we all know that collection of elements in the universe are called sets, and the collection of elements within the sets are called subsets. The collection of elements in the universe is called the whole set. The null set O, which is not no elements, analogous to the impossible events, and the whole set is analogous to certain event. Power set constitutes all possible sets of X denoted by Px. Let the universe comprise of four elements. Let us take an example here. 1, 2, 3, 4, and the cardinal number. Let us find out the cardinal number, power set, and the cardinality of the power set. The solution is, since there are four elements of a set, so it will be 4, and consists of four elements, therefore the cardinal number is equal to 4, and the power set consists of Px is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4, 2, 3, 2, 4, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 2, 3, 4, and we have 1, 3, 4, 1, 2, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. So these are the power sets. Cardinality of the power set is given by 2 raised to the power of x. So 2 raised to the power 4 is 16. Because if you count it, it is 16. Here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, and 16. Okay. So S A B C refers to set of set. A belongs to S elements, doesn't belong to S. This we have already discussed. The relation between sets. Definition: suppose A and B are sets, then A is called subset of B. A and is indicated as is a subset of B. Every element of A is also an element of B. Symbolically, it is represented as this one. A is a subset of B means for all X, if X belongs to A, then X belongs to B. Okay, so this is the definition of subset, and not a there exists X such that X belongs to A and X doesn't belong to B. This is the important point here. A is a subset of B means for all X, if X belongs to A, then X and X belongs to B. But here in this case, there exists X such that existential quantifier that X belongs to A and X doesn't belong to B. So this is the major difference between them. So here, if you see the diagram here, B and A is a subset of B. Every element of A is in the B. Here it is there. Every element of A is not there in the B and indicated as. Here some commonality is there, not complete. A equals to B. Every element in B is in A is in B, and every element of B is also in A. Symbolically, it is represented as A equals to B. A is a subset of B, and B is also a subset of A. Example: N belongs to Z. N is equal to 2k plus 3 for some integer k. B is the set of all odd integers. Set of all odd integers. Then A equals to. Here also we have written the same thing, 2k plus 3, and here set of all odd integers. Union of A and B, A union B is expressed as X belongs to U and X belongs to, such that X belongs to A or X belongs to B here. Or intersection of A and B. A intersection B is X belongs to A and X belongs to B. That is commonality. A B minus A, X belongs to B and X doesn't belong to A. Here. Complement of A, X belongs to A and X doesn't belong. X belongs to U and but X doesn't belong to A. Now here in this particular example, X is lying between 3 and 5 and B is in this X in B, X is lying in between 4 and 9, then A union B will be 3 to 9. That is all the elements. 3 to 9. 3 and then 9 here. Union operator. Union means X belongs to A or X belongs to B. Sab kuch hona, everything should be there in that. And A intersection B, what is the commonality? Commonality here it is. This is 5 and 4, therefore it is 4 and 5. X less greater than 4 and X less than 5 here. This is the commonality A intersection B here. B minus A and A minus B are shown here. Now, distributive law, A union B intersection C is A union B, A intersection C, and A union B intersection C is a subset of A union B intersection A union C, and A union B intersection A union C is a subset of A union B intersection C. So, the properties are commutative laws, associative laws, and distributive laws. Commutative laws means A intersection B is B intersection equal to A intersection B is equal to B intersection A, and in the case of associative law, A intersection B intersection C is A intersection B intersection C. Here in this case, A union B union C is equal to A union B union union C. Distributive law is this we have already done. Now if you see this particular example here, they have given A is 1, 2, 3, 4, B is 3, 4, 5, 6, C is 3, we want to perform B minus C, B minus C is 4, 5, 6, all the elements that are present in B but not in C, that is 3 is there and then it is discarded. A minus B minus C, this is B minus C is already there, A minus B minus C, and we will have only 1, 2, 3 and this 4, 5, 6 will not be there. And if you perform A minus B means this is A and this is B. If you perform A minus B, we will have 1 and 2, 3 and 4 are already there, therefore 1 and 2. A minus B minus C, that means 1, 2, and C is 3, and therefore it is 1, 2. Therefore, A minus B minus C not equal to A minus B minus C. Now in this A and B are called disjoints if and only if A intersection B is equal to 5 and sets A1, A2 and A3 are called mutually disjoint. If and only if for all I, J, 1, 2, A1, I intersection AJ belongs to 5 whenever I not equals to J. Now let us see the example here. A is 1, 2, B is 3, 4 are disjoints. The set of even and odd integers are disjoint. A 1 4, B 2 5, C 1 3 are mutually disjoint. A minus B, B minus A intersection B are mutually disjoint. So, this is the complete table that we have to. See, we have already done. This has already been discussed in the class, and the same thing has been discussed here. And in this particular lecture, you will find this. Now, let us take some examples on this. If A is given 9, 5, 6, 8, 10, B is 1, 2, 3, 7, 9, C is 1, 0, then define over a universe, set of all the natural numbers, prove the classical set properties, associativity, and distributivity. Now, associativity means A union B union C is equal to A union B union C. Now, how to start with it? Let us start with the left hand side. This is called LHS. We will start from this side. B union C. Now, what is B union C? Here, this is B and this is C. B union C means combination. So, it will be 0, 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, 7, 9. A union B union C, now the combined, it will be A, complete A will be there, then 5, 6, 8, 10, 2, 3, well, this is combined and now this is the result here. Now, we will start from the RHS, that is the right hand side. In the right hand side, we have this particular A union B union C, and now how will we solve? We will first solve A union B here and the value is A union B here. Now, next one, A union B union C is this value, A and B, and then we get union of C. Now, if you observe this one and this one, 2.1 and 2.2, you will find that LHS equals to RHS. Therefore, associativity has been proven, which means that A union B union C equals to A union B union C. Now, in the next case, A intersection B intersection C is equals to A intersection B intersection C. Now, let us start from the left hand side, and this is the right hand side from LHS. We will first try to prove this one, B intersection C is 1 and A intersection B intersection C is 5. There is nothing common in between them. So, now let us start with the RHS. A intersection B intersection C. Now, we will start with A intersection B, which is only 9 is there because there is only element, commonality element. And then A union B intersection C is 5. Now, 2.3 and 2.4, we will find that they are all equal. Therefore, associativity and distributivity has been proved. Now, in this particular case, if we try to prove the distributivity here, A union B intersection C is A union B intersection A union C. Therefore, we will try to prove individually this one and then this one, then we will make an intersection here. Here also, we will try to first have get the value of B intersection C and then we will make it with the union here, likewise as shown here. So, here we have the value 2.5, this is the value. In the case of RHS, we have A union B, A union C, A union B intersection A union C. So, this and this, if we compare here, and this is the results.